Now, let us describe the contents of the cranial cavity. The cranial cavity contains the brain, the largest and most important structure in the cranial cavity. And this brain is surrounded by three meninges: the dura mater, outermost layer, the arachnoid mater deeper to the dura mater, and the pia mater the deepest and in close contact with the surface of the brain. The pia mater is in close adherence to the surface of the brain, while the dura mater, the stronger, the more fibrous, and the outermost layer is adherent to the inner surface of the skull bones. This is the brain and the surrounding meninges. In addition to these structures, there are the 12 cranial nerves. The 12 cranial nerves, in addition to the pituitary gland or hypophysis. Let us begin with the cranial nerves in the cranial cavity. We have 12 cranial nerves arranged from before backward, from the first, the most anterior in the base, in the base on the floor of the cranial cavity, in the floor of the cranial cavity, to the 12th nerve, the most posterior in the floor of the cranial cavity, from before backward, arranged like this: the first followed by the second and third and so on. And we can call these cranial nerves by their numbers, in addition to calling them by their names. So let us begin by the first cranial nerve, which is number one cranial, marked by number one in the diagram. This is the olfactory nerve. The olfactory nerve is the first cranial nerve, the most anterior in the floor of the cranial cavity. And it enters the cranial cavity through the cribriform plate of the ethmoid, the perforated plate on the side of the crista galli. The olfactory nerve is formed of bundles, about 15 bundles, together form the nerve. The olfactory nerve, or the first cranial nerve. Then, going backward in the floor of the cranial cavity, there is the optic nerve number two. The optic nerve number two, or the second cranial nerve. The second cranial nerve. And it passes through the optic canal. The optic canal lies at the apex of the orbit. And the optic nerve passes through it. The optic nerve is the nerve of vision, while the olfactory nerve is the nerve of smell. So, number two is the optic nerve passing through the optic canal. Then, here we see the third cranial nerve, which is called oculomotor nerve. The third cranial nerve, or the oculomotor nerve, and is marked by number four. Oculomotor, because it supplies most of the muscles of the eyeball. Oculomotor, motor to the eye muscles. This is the third cranial nerve. And then the fourth cranial nerve, called the trochlear nerve, marked by number five. Marked by number five. The trochlear nerve, the fourth cranial nerve. It supplies one of the muscles of the eyeball, called the superior oblique muscle. Called the superior oblique muscle. And then the fifth cranial nerve, the fifth cranial nerve, which is a trigeminal nerve. The trigeminal nerve, which has three divisions, the ophthalmic, marked by number 3, passes through the superior orbital fissure, the maxillary, marked by number 10, passing through the foramen rotundum, and the mandibular division, marked by number 11, passing through the foramen ovale. These are the three divisions of the trigeminal nerve, which is the fifth cranial nerve. But the roots of the trigeminal nerve, are marked by number 12. The trigeminal nerve has a large sensory root and a small motor root, and they are marked by number 12. This trigeminal nerve is the fifth cranial nerve. Then the sixth cranial nerve, which is called abducens nerve. Abducens nerve marked by number 7. The abducens nerve and supplies only one muscle of the eyeball called the lateral rectus, muscle. Then behind the abducens nerve is the 7th and 8th cranial nerves. The 7th cranial nerve is the facial nerve. The 8th cranial nerve is the vestibulocochlear nerve, or called also auditory nerve. The 7th and 8th nerve lie within the internal auditory meatus number 13. Which is the internal auditory meatus. Then, after the 8th nerve, we have the 9th, 10th, and the 11th. The 9th is the glossopharyngeal, the 10th is the vagus, the 11th is the accessory nerve. They pass through the jugular foramen, number 14. Number 15 is one of the roots of the accessory nerve, called spinal root of the accessory nerve. Arises in the spinal cord and enters the foramen magnum and joins the cranial root of the accessory in the jugular foramen. This is the accessory nerve. So the 9th cranial nerve is the glossopharyngeal, the 10th cranial nerve is the vagus, the 11th cranial nerve is the accessory nerve. Accessory nerve has two roots, cranial root and the spinal root. The spinal root here is marked by number 15. Then the last cranial nerve is the 12th cranial nerve, or hypoglossal nerve, marked number 9. It enters through the condylar canal or hypoglossal canal in the base of the skull. And close to it, there is artery number 8. This is the vertebral artery. The vertebral artery that ascends in the neck within the foramina transverse area in the transverse processes of the cervical vertebrae. Here, it enters the cranial cavity through the foramen magnum. So these are the 12 cranial nerves from 1 to 12, and where they lie in the floor of the cranial cavity, from before backward. The first cranial nerve, the most anterior, the olfactory, then followed the optic nerve, the second, then the oculomotor, the third, then the trochlear, the fourth, then the trigeminal, the fifth, then the abducens, the sixth, then the facial, the seventh, then the vestibulocochlear or auditory, the eighth, then the glossopharyngeal, the ninth, then the vagus, the tenth, then the accessory nerve, the 11th, and lastly, most posterior, the hypoglossal, which is the 12th cranial nerve. These are the cranial nerves in the floor of the cranial cavity. This picture shows two folds of the dura mater. The dura mater is one of the contents of the cranial cavity. And these two folds, marked by number 1 and number 2, lie between the parts of the brain. The fold number 1 is called falx cerebri, and falx means sickle shaped, and it lies vertical and in the midline of the cranial cavity, in the midline, just below the sagittal suture of the skull. And it lies between the two cerebral hemispheres. It separates the two cerebral hemispheres from each other. And this sickle-shaped fold of dura mater has an upper convex border attached to the skull bones at the sagittal suture in the midline, while its lower concave border is free. This falx cerebri, falx means a sickle, has an anterior end which is narrow and pointed and attached to the crista galli anteriorly in the anterior cranial fossa, but its base is broader and is attached to another fold called tentorium cerebelli, marked by number 2. The base of the falx cerebri number 1 is attached to the upper surface of the tentorium cerebelli, which is marked number 2. This tentorium cerebelli is semilunar in shape. It is crescentic in shape, like a crescent. And it has an outer convex border attached to the bones of the skull, called the attached border, and an inner concave border free. Inner concave border is free, and it lies horizontal, covering the cerebellum, which lies in the posterior cranial fossa. The tentorium cerebelli, marked number 2, covers the cerebellum, which lies in the posterior cranial fossa. These folds of dura mater are derived from the inner layer of the dura. The dura mater surrounding the brain is formed of two layers, an outer layer towards the bones of the skull and an inner layer towards the cranial cavity, and the two layers are fused together. The two layers are fused together, except at certain sites where they are separated to form venous sinuses. Venous sinuses, channels filled with venous blood. These sinuses, therefore, are present either between the inner layer and outer layer of the dura mater, where they separate from each other at certain sites, or in the margins of the dural folds, or in the margins of the dural folds. And these dural folds are prolongations from the inner layer only of the dura mater. Prolongations of the inner layer of the dura mater of the brain. The dura mater of the brain, which is formed of two layers. Compared with the dura mater of the spinal cord, it is only formed of one layer. The spinal dura mater around the spinal cord is only formed of one layer, but the dura mater of the brain is formed of two layers to allow for formation of two things. Number one, to form the folds of the dura mater between the parts of the brain. Number two, to form the venous sinuses to form the venous sinuses between the inner layer and the outer layer or within the inner layer itself. These are the general features of the Falk cerebri number 1 and the tentorium cerebelli number 2, which are two large folds of dura mater inside the cranial cavity. This picture shows the venous sinuses related to the Falk cerebri, the dural fold, which lies vertically between the two hemispheres of the cerebrum. And we know that this Falk cerebri has an upper attached convex border attached to the skull bones at the sagittal suture, exactly. And here lies a venous sinus marked by number 1, and it's called the superior sagittal sinus. So the superior sagittal sinus lies in the attached border of the Falk cerebral, while the venous sinus present in the inferior concave border of the Falk cerebri, marked by number 5, is called the inferior sagittal sinus. The superior sagittal sinus extends all through the convex border from the anterior end to the posterior end. But the inferior sagittal sinus is present only in the posterior two-thirds or so in the inferior concave border. The inferior sagittal sinus, number 5, at its posterior end, it meets a straight sinus that runs anteroposterior, marked by number 2. It's called the straight sinus. And the straight sinus lies at the junction between the base of the Falk cerebri and the upper surface of the tentorium cerebellar, at the junction between the two folds, the straight sinus. And at the anterior end of the straight sinus, which is marked number 2, there is a vein opening into it. There is a vein joining it, number 6. It's called the great cerebral vein. Great cerebral vein draining the tissues of the brain. It's called the great cerebral vein. So there are three sinuses in the Falk cerebra, one in the attached border above, called the superior sagittal sinus, number 1, one in the free concave lower border, it's called the inferior sagittal sinus, marked by number 5, one at the attached base of the Falk cerebri with the tentorium cerebelli in the midline, and it's called the straight sinus, number 2. At the anterior end of the straight sinus, there is a great cerebral vein opens, but at its posterior end, at the bone attachment, there is a wide sinus called the confluence of sinuses. Confluence of sinuses means meeting of more than one sinus, where all more than one sinus open here, called the confluence, marked by number 3. And below this confluence, and below the tentorium cerebelli, there is a small fold called Falks, but between the two hemispheres of the cerebellum, in the posterior cranial fossa, and it is called the Falk cerebelli. And in the base of this Falk cerebelli, which is a small fold, vertical fold, lies a venous sinus marked by number 4, called the occipital sinus. So number 4 is the occipital sinus that lies in the attached border of the falx cerebellar. It is a small fold between the two cerebellar hemispheres in the posterior cranial fossa and lies also in the midline and at its base where it is attached or at its attached border there is a sinus called occipital sinus number 4. These are the venous sinuses related mainly to the falx cerebri as well as the occipital sinus in the falx cerebelli. This figure shows the tentorium cerebelli and the venous sinuses related to it. The tentorium cerebelli, as I mentioned before, is crescentic in shape, has an outer convex border attached to the bones of the skull called the attached border and an inner free concave border marked by number 1. Number 1 is the inner free concave border of the tentorium cerebelli and this tentorium is a horizontal fold of dura mater and it covers the cerebellum which lies in the posterior cranial fossa, so it acts like a tent for the cerebellum, hence it's called tentorium cerebelli. This tentorium cerebelli has venous sinuses as follows. Number 2 is the sinus called the superior petrosal sinus. Superior petrosal sinus that lies along the upper border of the petrous part of temporal bone and where the tentorium is attached. So number 2 is the site of superior petrosal sinus in the attached border of the tentorium to the petrous part of temporal bone. Number 3 is the transverse sinus because it runs transversely and lies at the site of attachment or line of attachment of the tentorium cerebelli to the occipital bone posteriorly on each side, of course. So there are superior petrosal sinus on the right side and the superior petrosal sinus on the left side. And there is a transverse sinus on the right side, number 3, and another one on the left side. But it has also a straight sinus in the midline, number 4. The straight line, the straight sinus. It is in a straight line in the midline at the junction between the base of the falx cerebri and the upper surface of the tentorium cerebelli. Here lies the straight sinus. And it is a single sinus, not paired, like the superior sagittal and inferior sagittal. So we have unpaired sinuses, but we have also paired sinuses, right and left. The single or unpaired are the superior sagittal sinus in the convex upper border of the falx cerebri, the inferior sagittal sinus in the free lower concave border of the falx cerebri, and the straight sinus at the junction of the base of the falx cerebri with the tentorium cerebelli. These are the three single unpaired, but we have also paired sinuses. For example, here the superior petrosal sinus number 2 is paired right and left. The transverse sinus number 3 right and left also paired. So these are the sinuses related to the tentorium cerebelli. This picture shows the features of the free border and attached border of the tentorium cerebelli. The attached border of the tentorium cerebelli, which is attached to the skull bones around it, and marked here by number 7. It is convex border attached, and at its anterior termination this attached border ends at what is called the posterior clinoid process number 4. The posterior clinoid process, and this posterior clinoid process is the lateral edge of the dorsum cilii of the cilia tarsica on the upper surface of the body of the sphenoid. So the attached border reaches forward as far as this process and is attached to it, the posterior clinoid process number 4. While the free border, the free border, concave border of the tentorium cerebelli, marked by number 1, it passes forward and crossing over the attached border, crosses over the attached border at the point marked by number 6, and continues forward to get attached to the anterior clinoid process number 5. The anterior clinoid process, which is the free end of the lesser wing of the sphenoid, which is the free posterior end of the lesser wing of the sphenoid, the anterior clinoid process number 5. So each border of the tentorium is attached to a clinoid process. Clinoid process. The attached border is attached to the posterior clinoid process number 4. While the free border, which is number 1, is attached to the anterior clinoid process number 5, and thus it crosses over the attached border. And at the point of crossing, which is number 6, at the point of crossing, the trochlear nerve pierces the dura mater. The trochlear nerve number 2, the trochlear nerve, which is the fourth cranial nerve, pierces the dura mater to enter the cavernous sinus. To enter the cavernous sinus. But after the crossing of the two borders, after the cross, the oculomotor nerve pierces the dura mater. The oculomotor nerve is the third cranial nerve, pierces the dura mater also to enter the cavernous sinus. So there are two cranial nerves related to the borders. Related to the borders of the tentorium cerebelli. A nerve piercing the dura mater at the point of crossing of the two borders, and this is the trochlear nerve. The point of crossing is number 6. The trochlear nerve is number 2. And the nerve that pierces the dura mater just in front, just beyond the point of crossing, is the oculomotor nerve, the third cranial nerve, to enter the cavernous sinus. Here in the diagram is marked by number 3. These are the important features of the free and attached borders of the tentorium cerebelli. This picture shows the inner aspect of the skull cap, or the inner aspect of the vault of the skull, to show the superior sagittal sinus, the superior sagittal sinus, which lies in the convex upper border of the falx cerebri, and here it lies in the midline exactly opposite the sagittal suture, and hence it is called sagittal. The superior sagittal sinus is narrow anteriorly, but it widens as it goes posteriorly, so its posterior part is wider, and it receives venous spaces, wide venous spaces on each side, called venous lacunae. Venous lacunae. Lacunae means wide space. The superior sagittal sinus here in the diagram is marked by number 3. The venous lacuna, one of the venous lacunae, is marked by number 1. So in each side, there are about three venous lacunae opening into the superior sagittal sinus. The venous lacunae are white spaces as in the diagram. These lacunae receive what is called arachnoid granulations, marked by number 2, arachnoid granulations, masses of arachnoid tissue and villi, arachnoid tissue from the arachnoid matter. And these arachnoid granulations derived from the arachnoid matter project into the lacunae, venous lacunae of the superior sagittal sinus. And through these granulations, arachnoid granulations, cerebrospinal fluid in the subarachnoid space is drained into the superior sagittal sinus. The superior sagittal sinus receives the cerebrospinal fluid from the subarachnoid space around the brain. How? By the arachnoid granulations. The arachnoid granulations, which are masses of arachnoid tissue of the arachnoid matter, are responsible for the flow of the cerebrospinal fluid into the superior sagittal sinus. The arachnoid granulations on each side opening into the venous lacunae. And this is an important point. When you are asked what is the fate of the cerebrospinal fluid, you have to answer the cerebrospinal fluid eventually drains into the superior sagittal sinus venous blood. So it enters the venous blood in the superior sagittal sinus. How? Through the arachnoid granulations. And what are the arachnoid granulations? These are masses of arachnoid tissue and the subarachnoid spaces. In addition to these lacunae that open into the superior sagittal sinus, the superior sagittal sinus also receives cerebral veins from the upper surface of the brain. Cerebral veins, they drain their blood into the superior sagittal sinus, not shown in the diagram, and also receives meningeal veins also. They communicate with the superior sagittal sinus. Of course, in addition to the venous lacunae, which I just mentioned now. This picture shows the base of the skull from inside the cranial cavity to show the paired sinuses, right and left sinuses. Let us begin by number 1. Number 1 is the cavernous sinus. It is a large sinus that contains trabeculae of fibrous tissue, which divides it into compartments, small spaces or compartments or caves, and that is why it is called the cavernous. And this cavernous sinus lies one on each side of the body of the sphenoid in the middle cranial fossa. So number 1 is the cavernous sinus, just behind the superior orbital fissure and in front of the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone. Here also there is a fine sinus lying on the edge of the lesser wing of the sphenoid. The lesser wing of the sphenoid forms the upper boundary of the superior orbital fissure. But this sphenoparietal sinus is not shown in the figure. It lies on the lesser wing of the sphenoid. extending from the body of the sphenoid medially to the parietal bone laterally. Then, number two is the inferior petrosal sinus. It lies along the lower border of the petrous part of the temporal bone. Number two, inferior petrosal sinus. And it communicates anteriorly with the cavernous sinus. But posteriorly, it passes through the medial end of the jugular foramen to join the internal jugular vein, to join the beginning of the internal jugular vein in the cavernous sinus, in the jugular foramen. And here in the jugular foramen, there are three nerves passing into it, marked by number 7. These are the glossopharyngeal nerve, the vagus nerve, and the accessory nerve in the middle part of the jugular foramen. But in the lateral part of the jugular foramen, there is the sigmoid sinus, marked by number 6. The sigmoid sinus is the shape, and it ends in the lateral part of the jugular foramen by forming the beginning of the internal jugular vein. The sigmoid sinus, which is marked by number 6, is formed by the union of the transverse sinus number 5, the transverse sinus which lies transversely on the inner aspect of the occipital bone. By the joining of this sinus, the transverse sinus number 5, with the superior petrosal sinus. The sigmoid sinus is formed by the union of these two sinuses, the transverse sinus number 5 and the superior petrosal sinus, which is marked number 4 and lies along the upper border of the petrous part of the temporal bone. These are the sinuses on the right side of the base of the skull from inside. Also, there is another sinuses on the left side. So, the venous blood in these sinuses flows from anterior to posterior. The blood flows from the cavernous sinus and the sphenoparietal sinus anteriorly backward through the superior petrosal sinus number 4 and the inferior petrosal sinus number 2 to end in the sigmoid sinus number 6 and then into the internal jugular vein. So the internal jugular vein in the front of the neck gets the venous blood of the whole cranial cavity, from the brain and the meninges around the brain through these sinuses. All the blood in the venous sinuses, dural sinuses, whether single or paired, drains finally into the sigmoid sinus number 6 and from the sigmoid sinus into the internal jugular vein, one on each side. And the internal jugular vein on each side carry the blood to the right atrium. In the figure also you can see the trigeminal ganglion in the middle cranial fossa, which is number 3. This picture shows the flow of venous blood in the dural venous sinuses from before backward to end eventually into the internal jugular veins of both sides. Let us begin by number 2, which is the superior sagittal sinus present in the upper convex attached border of the falx cerebri. and the blood in it passes from before backward. Number one is the inferior sagittal sinus. It is also a single sinus. It lies in the posterior two-thirds of the lower inferior border of the falx cerebri, and the blood in it also passes from before backwards. Number three is the straight sinus. It lies in the base of the falx cerebri at its attachment to the tentorium cerebelli, and it receives at its anterior end the great cerebral vein, which is marked by number 11, while its posterior end joins a confluence of sinuses, a wide space, venous space, lying in front of the internal occipital protuberance that receives the sinuses from the falx cerebri and the straight sinus. And this confluence of sinuses will give rise to the transverse sinus on each side. The transverse sinus lies transversely on the inner aspect of the occipital bone, and here in the figure is marked by number 4 and shows the blood passing through it from medial to lateral to end in the sigmoid sinus. The sigmoid sinus means S-shape and is marked here by number 5. The sigmoid sinus is formed by the union of the transverse sinus with the superior petrosal sinus. The superior petrosal sinus is number 8. And this superior petrosal sinus joins the cavernous sinus number 10 with the beginning of the sigmoid sinus. The cavernous sinus also, number 10, is connected with the beginning of the internal jugular vein, which is number 7, with the inferior petrosal sinus, marked by number 9. So the blood in the cavernous sinus also passes backward, from before backward, through the superior petrosal sinus, number 8, to reach the sigmoid sinus, and through the inferior petrosal sinus, number 9, to reach the beginning of the internal jugular vein. So again, the sigmoid sinus, number 5, is S-shaped. It is formed by the union of the transverse sinus, number 4, with the superior petrosal sinus, number 8. And this sigmoid sinus, which is S-shaped, carries the blood to the internal jugular vein. The sigmoid sinus becomes the beginning of the internal jugular vein by passing through the jugular foramen, number 6. Number 7 is the beginning of the internal jugular vein, and here is the eventual drainage of the venous blood from the dural venous sinuses. Here, let us describe in detail the cavernous sinus, which is an important dural sinus. This cavernous sinus is filled with trabeculae of fibrous tissue, so it is divided into multiple spaces. And this sinus, large sinus, relatively large sinus, lies one on each side of the body of the sphenoid. And the body of the sphenoid forms the median part of the floor of the middle cranial fossa, the elevated median or middle part. And here in the figure is number 1, shows that the body of the sphenoid contains sphenoidal air sinus, which may be divided into by a septum into two spaces. So number 1 is the body of this sphenoid bone. and on each side lies the cavernous sinus in the dura mater. In the dura mater. And this cavernous sinus that lies on the side of the body of the sphenoid extends from the superior orbital fissure anteriorly to the apex of the petrous bone posteriorly. And therefore, the cavernous sinus lies in the middle cranial fossa, just behind the orbit, just behind the apex of the orbit. And it has four walls: lateral wall, medial wall, roof and floor, and a cavity inside, of course. And the medial wall of the cavernous sinus, which is directed medially, is related above to the pituitary gland or hypophysis, marked by number two. This pituitary gland lies on the upper surface of the body of the sphenoid in what's called a pituitary fossa, which is a part of the cilia tersica, which is part of the cilia tersica, and is related medially also to the body of the sphenoid, where the sphenoidal air sinus lies. These are the relations of the medial wall of the cavernous sinus. The lateral wall of the cavernous sinus shows a number of nerves passing through the lateral wall itself and are arranging from above downward as follows. Number four is the highest, and this is the oculomotor nerve. Number five is below it. This is the trochlear nerve, the trochlear nerve. Number six is the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, while the lowermost, which is number nine, is the maxillary division of the trigeminal nerve. These are nerves present in the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus, in the lateral wall itself. While the structures in the cavity, passing in the cavity of the cavernous sinus, are two structures. Number 11 is the internal carotid artery, and here the internal carotid artery is in contact with the body of the sphenoid, forming a deep groove on the side of the body of the sphenoid. And just lateral to the internal carotid artery, which is number 11, there is the abducens nerve. The abducens nerve, which is the sixth cranial nerve, and it lies just lateral to the internal carotid artery. These are the two structures in the cavity of the cavernous sinus: the internal carotid artery, number 11, and the abducens nerve, number 10. These are the structures inside the cavernous sinus. Note number 7. Number 7 is the apex or pole, anterior pole of the temporal lobe of the brain, which lies in the middle cranial fossa. It lies lateral to the cavernous sinus. It is related to the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. Note also number 8. This is the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve. It is outside the cavernous sinus. It is away from the cavernous sinus. It is passing through the foramen ovale. Number 3 is the internal carotid artery, as it leaves the cavernous sinus through its roof. It pierces its roof to reach the base of the brain. So number 3 is the internal carotid artery piercing the roof of the cavernous sinus. Number 11 is the cavernous sinus, is the internal carotid artery in the cavity of the cavernous sinus. These are important relations of the cavernous sinus. This picture shows the many tributaries of the cavernous sinus and its communication with the sigmoid sinus and the internal jugular vein. Number 5 is the cavernous sinus and receives many tributaries. Number 4 is a vein called the superficial middle cerebral vein. Superficial middle cerebral vein draining part of the lateral surface of the cerebrum. Lateral surface of the cerebrum. And this superficial middle cerebral vein is connected indirectly with the superior sagittal sinus. And through this superficial middle cerebral vein, the superior sagittal sinus communicates with the cavernous sinus. Number 6 is the superior ophthalmic vein. The superior ophthalmic vein that lies in the cavity of the orbit near its roof and joins the beginning of the facial vein in the face, the beginning at the medial angle of the eye, joining it with the cavernous sinus. This is number 6, the superior ophthalmic vein, and is one of the veins that may carry infection from the face to the cavernous sinus. Number 7 is the sphenoparietal sinus that lies at the edge, along the edge of the lesser wing of the sphenoid. It opens into the cavernous sinus as one of its tributaries. Number 8 is the end of the anterior division of the middle meningeal vein. Communication between the middle meningeal vein that drains anterior division of the middle meningeal vein and drains here into the cavernous sinus. Number 9 is the emissary vein that passes through the foramen ovale and communicates the cavernous sinus with the pterygoid plexus of veins that lies in the infratemporal fossa. These are tributaries which carry their venous blood to end into the cavernous sinus. In addition to these tributaries, but not shown in the diagram, there are intercavernous connections between the right cavernous sinus and the left cavernous sinus. They are connected with each other by venous channels, intercavernous veins or connections. Number 10 is the superior petrosal sinus that carries the blood from the cavernous sinus to the beginning of the sigmoid sinus. The sigmoid sinus is number 2. And it is shown that this sigmoid sinus is a continuation of the transverse sinus, which is number 1. The inferior petrosal sinus, which is number 11, connects the cavernous sinus to the beginning of the internal jugular vein. This inferior petrosal sinus passes through the medial part of the jugular foramen and carries the blood to the internal jugular vein directly. The internal jugular vein is marked by number 3. This is a coronal section in the body of the sphenoid to show the position of the pituitary gland or hypophysis cerebri. The pituitary gland or hypophysis cerebri, marked by number 4, lies on the upper surface of the body of the sphenoid in what is called the pituitary fossa, and the pituitary fossa is a part of the cella tercica, and the cella tercica is the upper surface of the body of the sphenoid. The pituitary gland here in the coronal section lies over the body of the sphenoid, which shows inside it the two compartments of the sphenoidal air sinus. And the pituitary gland is covered above by two folds of dura mater marked by number one. These folds are called diaphragma cilii. Diaphragma cilii because these folds lie over the pituitary gland and over the cilia tersica, forming a sort of diaphragm, fold of dura, acting as a diaphragm above the cilia tersica and covering the pituitary gland. So number one is the diaphragma cilii, and this diaphragma cilii is perforated in its middle by the stalk of the pituitary gland. The stalk is number three, and this stalk is connected above with the hypothalamus, which lies in the floor of the third ventricle. Number two is the part of the hypothalamus which lies in the floor of the third ventricle. So it is a part of the hypothalamus. The pituitary gland, number four, is connected with the hypothalamus above through a stalk. The stalk is called number three. And this stalk passes through a perforation into the diaphragma cilii, which is a fold of dura mater, number one. On each side of the pituitary gland lies a cavernous sinus. The cavernous sinus is marked by number five. These are the features of the pituitary gland to show its position, the position of the pituitary gland. It lies in the middle of the middle cranial fossa. This is a sagittal section through the pituitary gland, sagittal from anterior to posterior, from before backward. And here the pituitary gland is seen marked by number one, and it lies in its fossa on the upper surface of the body of the sphenoid. The pituitary fossa, a part of the cilia tersica on the upper surface of the body of the sphenoid. And this fossa, as we see, it is concave. And if this pituitary gland or hypophysis cerebri is affected by a tumor and it becomes enlarged in size, it will enlarge its fossa. And this fossa, when it is enlarged, becomes easily diagnosed by an X-ray side view. The fossa becomes elongated, boat-like, deep fossa, and this will denote that the pituitary gland is enlarged, leading to this changes in the pituitary fossa. But normally, the pituitary fossa is more or less circular and not so deep. Number three is a groove called optic groove. The optic groove in the base of the skull from inside connects the optic canal of one side to the optic canal of the opposite side. And it is related to the optic chiasma. The optic chiasma is number two. But the optic chiasma is not in direct contact with the groove, but it is close to it. This optic chiasma number two is decussation of the nasal or medial fibers of the optic nerves of both sides. The nasal fibers or medial fibers of the right optic nerve decussate with those of the opposite side, of the optic nerve of the opposite side. This decussation forms what's called the optic chiasma. Chiasma means X shape, like an X, letter X. And here this optic chiasma has an important relation to the pituitary gland because it lies above and anterior to the pituitary gland. And therefore, if there is a swelling of the pituitary gland by a tumor, and this swelling extends upward and forward, it will compress on the decussation of the optic nerve fibers of the nasal fibers, the optic chiasma, leading to blindness affecting these fibers only, the nasal fibers, because the nasal fibers are those which decussate, because the optic nerve has temporal or lateral fibers. They do not decussate, but the medial or nasal fibers are those which decussate. And these fibers which decussate are those fibers in the optic chiasma, and they are exposed to be compressed in cases of enlargement upward of the pituitary gland. So this relation is of importance clinically. Number four is the sphenoidal ear sinus, as it lies in the body of the sphenoid, the sphenoidal ear sinus. And we know this is sphenoidal ear sinus, like any other nasal sinuses, they open into the nasal cavity. They open into the nasal cavity. And surgeons use this route through the nose and through this sphenoidal ear sinus to reach the pituitary gland, and can remove a tumor from the pituitary gland. So it is a surgical pathway used by surgeons to reach the pituitary gland. The sphenoidal ear sinus lies below and in front of the pituitary gland, and it opens into the nasal cavity. These are important relations to the pituitary gland as seen from the side. This is a pituitary gland in a sagittal section, anteroposterior section, to show its two parts, or lobes, anterior lobe and posterior lobe. The anterior lobe of the pituitary gland, which is marked by number 4, is called adenohypophysis. Anterior lobe of the pituitary gland is called adeno, and adeno means gland. And it's called adenohypophysis because it secretes many hormones that control other endocrine glands in the body. And this adenohypophysis, or the anterior lobe of the pituitary gland, is not connected directly with the brain. But is connected through venous channels, veins that arise in the hypothalamus above, these veins, and descend in the stalk of the pituitary gland and end in the adenohypophysis or anterior lobe. And through these veins, venous blood carries the neurotransmitters from the hypothalamus to the anterior lobe of the pituitary gland, or adenohypophysis. So it is not connected by nerve fibers. It is only connected through venous channels. And this venous connections with the adenohypophysis is called portal hypophyseal circulation. It is called portal because these veins begin by fine tributaries in the hypothalamus and end in the pituitary gland by fine branches. Begins by branches and ends by branches. So, like a portal circulation. So, it is called the portal hypophyseal circulation. And by this, the hypothalamus, by indirect way, can control the adenohypophysis. By indirect way, through the blood. But the posterior lobe of the hypophysis, or the pituitary gland, marked by number 3, it is connected directly with the hypothalamus through nerve fibers, and therefore it is called the neurohypophysis. Neurohypophysis means part related to the nervous system. It is a part related to the hypothalamus. The neurohypophysis, the posterior lobe of the pituitary, is connected by nerve fibers arising from the floor of the third ventricle, the hypothalamus, lies in the floor of the hypothalamus. The floor of the third ventricle, the floor, this hypothalamus lies in the floor of the third ventricle. And in this part of the hypothalamus, there are two important nuclei that control the posterior lobe of the pituitary gland. These are called supraoptic and paraventricular nuclei. Number one in the diagram shows the supraoptic and paraventricular nuclei, which are parts of the hypothalamus, and these nuclei send axons or fibers or a tract, nerve tract, through the stalk of the pituitary to relay into the neurohypophysis or posterior lobe of the pituitary gland, marked by number 3. So number 2 represent the nerve tract, the nerve fibers connecting the hypothalamus above to the posterior lobe of the pituitary gland, which is also called the neurohypophysis. These two lobes or two parts of the pituitary gland, they are not only different functionally, but they are also different embryologically, because the adenohypophysis arises from the roof of the primitive mouse, the primitive mouse in the fetus called the stomodium, and ascends upward, while the neurohypophysis is a diverticulum from the neural tube, from the neural tube, which is nervous, and it descends downward, and they meet each other and becomes adherent to each other. So the two parts of the pituitary gland, although they are of ectodermal origin, arise from ectodermal cells in the fetus, but they are derived from different sources. The adenohypophysis arises from a diverticulum from the roof of the stomodium, the primitive mouse of the fetus, called Rasca's pouch, from the roof of the primitive mouse, not the final mouse of the adult, but the primitive mouse of the fetus, called the stomodium. And this diverticulum is called Rasca's pouch. It will form the anterior lobe of the pituitary gland, while the posterior lobe is developed from a diverticulum or elongation from the floor of the neural tube, the area of the hypothalamus. And as I mentioned before, they will meet each other and form the whole pituitary gland or hypophysis cerebri that lies in its place in the pituitary fossa.